This week on Vaticano, discover the relationship between the Holy See and the United States during the papacy of Pope Pius XII.
Boniface VIII.
Sit down with Professor Dr. Johannes Grohe to learn about the tradition of Jubilee Years and how they connect to indulgences, pilgrimage, and the forgiveness of sins. And journey to Assisi to traverse the decision door that St. Francis of Assisi crossed during momentous moments of his life. For this and more, Vaticano starts now.
Tu sei Pietro, e su questa pietra edificherò la mia chiesa.
A new film, Follow Me, The Life of St. Peter, will be projected onto the facade of St. Peter's Basilica until October the 16th. Every evening at 9 p.m., the 9-minute film will be shown using the latest 3D technology with large video projectors. The film tells the story of St. Peter, the first pope, using images from St. Peter's Basilica and the Vatican Museums. The multimedia project is an initiative promoted by the Fondazione Fratelli Tutti, the Fabrica di San Pietro, and the parish of St. Peter's Basilica. At the first screening on October the 2nd, Cardinal Mauro Gambetti, Vicar General for Vatican City, thanked all those involved and welcomed a special guest, the internationally renowned tenor Andrea Bocelli, who performed a musical tribute to celebrate the special occasion. The video project is one of many initiatives introducing the Apostle Peter to the faithful. In those places in Rome that have to do with the history of the first pope, further stages of a spiritual pilgrimage will be created starting in December at the request of the Holy Father.
Decernimus ut beati Ioannis Baptista Scalabrini e Artemide Satti, die nono mensis octobris, anno bismillesimo vicesimo secondo, in sanctorum album referantur.
On October the 9th, Pope Francis rose two new saints to the honor of the altar in Rome, Blessed Artemide Zatti and Blessed Giovanni Battista Scalabrini. Artemide Zatti was born in Italy and emigrated with his family to Argentina in 1897 at the age of 16 because of extreme poverty in his home country. 4 years later, Zatti decided to become a Salesian priest, but after contracting and recovering from tuberculosis, Zatti promised to devote his life to helping the sick. Giving up his hopes for the priesthood, Zatti became the director of the Salesian-run hospital in Viedma, a city in central Argentina. 2 years later, he received his license as a professional nurse. Zatti also traveled to the peripheries of Viedma and the neighboring city of Carmen de Patagones to treat people in need. People who knew him said that Zatti carried out his service to the sick with heroic sacrifice and that he radiated the light of God, even bringing some unbelievers to faith. On March the 15th, 1951, at the age of 70, he died of liver cancer. Blessed Giovanni Battista Scalabrini also comes from Italy. Born in 1839 in the region of Lombardy, Scalabrini was ordained a priest in 1863 and made Bishop of Piacenza in 1876. As bishop, he founded the missionaries of St. Charles Borromeo, also known as the Scalabrinians, and created the St. Raphael Association that was dedicated to offering pastoral care to migrants leaving Italy at the turn of the 20th century. As well as founding a diocesan newspaper, Scalabrini promoted Eucharistic adoration and worked to protect correct liturgical chant. In 1901, he visited his missionaries in the United States and was received at the White House by President Theodore Roosevelt. He was described by Pope Pius IX as the Apostle of the Catechism. Speaking to members of the congregation founded by Scalabrini in October of 2018, Pope Francis called on the religious to walk with migrants, following the charism of their founder, by paying attention to the dignity of the human person, especially where it is most wounded and threatened.
Hello and welcome to this week's Vaticano Updates, the most important news from the Holy Father and the Vatican. In his Angelus address on the 2nd of October, Pope Francis made a direct appeal to Vladimir Putin for an immediate ceasefire, imploring him to end the spiral of violence and death in Ukraine. The Holy Father dedicated nearly all of his address to the war in Ukraine and warned that the conflict could develop into a nuclear escalation. Daniel Ortega, the president of Nicaragua, called Pope Francis a holy tyrant and said that the Catholic Church is the perfect dictatorship in his speech marking the 43rd anniversary of the founding of the National Police. His speech attacked the pontiff directly, questioning the democratic authority of Pope Francis. He questioned why the pope was not elected through the votes of all Catholics. The president of the Vatican's Pontifical Council for Promoting Christian Unity, Cardinal Kurt Koch, has defended himself against an accusation by the president of the German Bishops' Conference, Bishop Georg Batzing, of making a totally unacceptable gaffe over remarks regarding the German Synodal Way. Bishop Batzing believed that Cardinal Koch had compared the Synodal Way to Nazi ideology. Koch had challenged the discussions of new sources of revelation at the German Synodal Way and pointed out how German Christians of the 20th century had seen God's new revelation in blood and soil and in the rise of Hitler. Pope Francis has said that he was involved in a prisoner swap between Russia and Ukraine. Speaking to Jesuits during his trip to Kazakhstan in September, the Pope said a Ukrainian military chief and President Zelensky's religious advisor came to him with a request for help, bringing with him a list of more than 300 prisoners that they wanted to exchange. The Holy Father immediately called the Russian ambassador to see if the exchange could be sped up. Pope Francis has repeatedly condemned the war in Ukraine, calling for peace and an end to conflict. With the start of October, Missionary Month has begun. The climax of the month will be World Mission Day on October 23rd. In his message for World Mission Day at Epiphany, Pope Francis reminded the faithful that this year marks the 400-year anniversary of the founding of the Congregation de Propaganda Fide, now known as the Congregation for the Evangelization of Peoples, as well as the 200-year anniversary of the Society for the Propagation of the Faith. The theme of this year's World Mission Day will be the last words of Christ to his disciples, "You shall be my witnesses." Thank you for watching this week's Vaticano Updates. I'm Benjamin Crockett for EWTN Vaticano.
In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. With the opening of the Vatican archives surrounding Pope Pius XII and his papacy, a closer look at this transformative leader is possible. The first half of the 20th century experienced turmoil and challenges that shook the world and brought the United States to the forefront of world affairs. Pope Pius XII, who at the time was known as Cardinal Eugenio Pacelli, became the highest level Vatican official to visit the United States in 1936. He fostered a warm and collaborative relationship with four sitting U.S. presidents. Professor Father Roberto Regoli is an historian of church history and teaches students at the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. We spoke with him on U.S. Holy See diplomatic relations and why they became official so late in the 20th century. We also spoke with him on how Pope Pius XII specifically brought these two great powers closer together.
The relationship between the Holy See and the United States really came into being in the modern era. The crisis of the 1800s made relations come to an end. In fact, the funds for American representation in Rome have been taken away. The reasons were political and not economic. What happened in the 1900s is that the United States, after World War I, became a superpower. And at the same time, the papacy was also another superpower, and you can't ignore each other. Within the diplomacy of the United States, Rome is seen as a place of listening, that is, a significant place globally where you can have many relationships, even with countries not so close to the United States. So, an important role, and during the time of World War II, we had a representative of the President of the United States of America, first Roosevelt, and then Truman at the Holy See. What happens? We move forward into the 1980s, when under President Ronald Reagan and the pontificates of John Paul II, new diplomatic relations are established after more than 100 years.
One of the key reasons why Pope Pius XII was able to play such a major role in shaping Vatican policy towards the United States was because he was Pope for such a long time, from 1939 to 1958. And because he reigned under such extreme circumstances, experiencing World War II and the start of the Cold War, the Holy See was forced to be a protagonist in order to ensure the protection of the faithful and vulnerable.
Sappiamo che ha tentato di portare avanti una diplomazia umanitaria.
What does Pius XII accomplish? During World War II, we know that he tried to carry out a humanitarian diplomacy to aid prisoners, those who were persecuted. He also tried to help German groups who were opposed to Hitler during World War II. When in the United States of America, some Catholics did not want to help the Soviet Union in the war against Nazism, because the Soviet Union was communist. The Pope, however, worked to remove the doubts from these Catholics, that at that time, it was important to help the Soviet Union fight Nazism. So, during World War II, the papacy took a firm stand. This was important because up to that time, in international politics, the Pope had always attempted to be neutral with respect to others, that is, impartial from several points of view. The Vatican typically took a policy of extreme neutrality. With Pius XII, there was a change. It began at a practical level by favoring certain political stances. Why? Because these political positions were helping Catholicism. They were defending religious interests, and at that time, liberal democracies were more able to guarantee those freedoms.
Erano più garantiste di tutti gli altri sistemi.
One of the keys to understanding Pope Pius XII's relationship with the U.S. is Cardinal Francis Spellman. They were close friends dating back to the time when Pope Pius XII was still Cardinal Eugenio Pacelli. Cardinal Francis Spellman served first as Auxiliary Bishop of the Archdiocese of Boston and then as Archbishop of New York.
I rapporti di Pacelli.
Pacelli's relation with the American presidents and the top levels of American politics were mediated mainly by men closest to Pacelli, not so much by apostolic delegates. But we have to remember this is fundamental friendship with Bishop Spellman, then Cardinal, because he was really Pacelli's American man. He was the real key to political power. They say, and in their drafting of friendship that preceded the pontificates, which has related to the days of the Secretariat of State, of the still young Pacelli, that you can understand the privileged relationship with the United States. Spellman is the key to the understanding of that moment.
La chiave della comprensione del momento.
Pope Pius XII was able to use the moral weight of the Church to confront the two primary ideological battles of the 20th century, first in Nazism and then in communism. Both presented themselves as totalitarian systems of political control.
I ruoli di Pio XII variano.
The roles of Pius XII vary according to the danger he had before him, because Nazism on a chronological level was for a much shorter period of time than communism. And the confrontation with communism was not only during the 20th century, but it was also already here in the 19th century. We have bishops at the local level in provincial councils condemning communism. So the anti-communist attitude of the Catholic Church had been present since the previous century. Nazism, on the other hand, was something new that arrived very quickly. But its gravity and seriousness was understood by the German bishops and the Holy See. There was first an ideological confrontation and then a practical confrontation. With communism, it was a bit more complex because it was not a problem with one country, but a problem with many countries.
Il problema con un solo paese, ma un problema con più paesi.
While the Vatican Apostolic Archives have been open since the time of the papacy of Pope Leo XIII, this is the first time they've been opened for consultation regarding the papacy of Pope Pius XII. Hopefully, Pope Pius XII will be seen in a more human light, with the documentation showing all that he did to secure the protection and humanitarian assistance for many during World War II. Also in particular, as a figure with a lead role in shaping diplomatic relations with the U.S. during such a sensitive period in history.
Let you keep always close to God.
Qui a Roma, nell'ambito del Giubileo del 2025.
On the final evening of the 10th World Meeting of Families in Rome, Cardinal Kevin Farrell announced at the Holy Mass with Pope Francis that 2025 will be celebrated as a Jubilee Year. The motto for the Jubilee Year is Pilgrims of Hope. According to the initiators, however, the motto is intended above all to show that pilgrimage is not an individual path, but a communal path, whose movement is increasingly oriented toward the cross.
Pilger der Hoffnung.
Pilgrims of hope. The Holy Father has in his mind, as he expressed himself in a letter he wrote to the organizer of the Jubilee, Archbishop Rino Fisichella, who has prepared this Jubilee with his collaborators, of course. Here is the idea. We had a great ordinary Jubilee in 2000 that many of us still remember well with John Paul II. Pope Francis then asked for a special holy year, the Holy Year of Mercy in 2016, and now 2025 is another ordinary holy year.
Ordentliches heiliges Jahr.
Johannes Grohe is professor of ancient and medieval church history at the Pontifical University of the Holy Cross in Rome. He has studied the tradition of the Jubilee years and how they connect to the tradition of indulgences, pilgrimage, and the forgiveness of sins.
Dann ab 1300 beginnt die Serie der ordentlichen.
Then from 1300 onwards, the series of ordinary holy years begins. This was first to be celebrated every 100 years. Then it was every 50 years, then every 25 years or 33 years after the years of the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. There were some fluctuations over the centuries. Basically, the pattern of every 25 years has prevailed, with some holes over the course of history. 2025 would be an ordinary holy year in which the Pope invites pilgrims to Rome to visit the Roman basilicas, to walk through the holy door and to fulfill the conditions that have already been mentioned, that is of receiving the sacraments and completing a pious pilgrimage.
In the Middle Ages, pilgrimages to Jerusalem, the Camino de Santiago, and also making a pilgrimage to Rome were very popular. To regulate the flow of pilgrims, Pope Boniface VIII issued the bull, Antiquorum Abet Fida Relatio, in 1300.
Boniface VIII verkündet den Ablass, also, dass die Gläubigen.
Pope Boniface VIII, who at that time was Bishop of Rome, responded by issuing the famous bull of indulgence. We still have a picture of it. This fresco is in the Lateran Basilica. Boniface VIII proclaimed that the faithful who received the sacrament of penance, who received the Eucharist, and took upon themselves a pilgrimage would receive the plenary indulgence. Boniface VIII was inspired by a jubilee that had taken place a few years earlier in 1294.
In addition to the ordinary jubilee years, there have also been extraordinary jubilee years throughout the history of the Church. For example, Pope Paul VI had a year of faith in 1967. Pope Benedict had a Pauline year. And most recently, Pope Francis declared the Holy Year of Mercy in 2016. For the faithful, these are good opportunities to reconcile with God.
Jubilees, since the beginning of the 14th century, provide for the faithful a way to receive the sacrament of penance, to receive the Holy Eucharist and to take upon themselves this penitential work, in this case, a pilgrimage to a sacred site. The faithful can gain many indulgences if they, for example, participate in a spiritual retreat, if they make a pilgrimage, if they perform works of charity, and if they assist the sick. These works of charity and piety are connected with an indulgence, which the Church then defines in detail as plenary or partial indulgence.
We'll be back after a short break with more on Vaticano. Saint Francis of Assisi is one of the most beloved and famous saints in the world. Giovanni di Pietro di Bernardone was born in late 1181 or early 1182 in Assisi. A poet and religious man, he founded the order that would later take his name, the Franciscans. He's venerated as a saint by the Catholic Church and the Anglican Communion. Proclaimed along with St. Catherine of Siena as the principal patron saint of Italy, his liturgical memory is celebrated on October the 4th throughout the Catholic Church. As a very wealthy young man, Francis's conversion upon hearing the voice of Christ from the cross of San Damiano led him to radical change. He became profoundly ascetic and was also known as the poor man of Assisi, because of his choice to rid himself of all material possessions. In his last written work, The Testament, St. Francis said that absolute personal and corporate poverty was the essential lifestyle for members of his order. Recently, the door through which Francis entered at important moments of decision in his life was uncovered.
I stress that this door was for Francis the door of decision, the door of conversion, because when he came here, he had already decided to renounce all his earthly goods. And it's so beautiful to think that he came in, that he was the most rich of Assisi, and after some hours he went out, that he was the most poor. He had made a radical decision that corresponded to gospel radicality.
Many of the stories that surround the life of Francis tell of his great love for animals and the environment. In addition to his spiritual work, Francis is recognized as one of the initiators of the Italian literary tradition, thanks to his Canticle of Creatures. He died in Assisi on October the 3rd, 1226. Cardinal Jorge Mario Bergoglio, elected Pope in the 2013 conclave, assumed the pontifical name Francis, precisely in honor of the Saint of Assisi. He was the first Pope to take this name in history. The city of Assisi, because of Saint Francis, its illustrious citizen, has risen up as a symbol of peace. It hosted four major meetings between the leaders of the world's largest religions under Pope John Paul II in 1986. St. Francis honors the city of Assisi to this day, and this door of decision cements his legacy within the city.
A door of conversion, a door of decision, because we have the temptation to live all our life with a foot on a side, a foot on the other side of this threshold. But we must take a decision, we must take a risk of a decision in our life.